Harper Audio presents The Fort by Bernard Cornwell, performed by Robin Bowerman.
Excerpt of letter from the Massachusetts Council to Brigadier General Solomon Lovell, July 2, 1779. You will, in all your operations, consult with the commander of the fleet that the naval force may cooperate with the troops under your command in endeavoring to captivate, kill, or destroy the whole force of the enemy there, both by sea and land. And as there is good reason to believe that some of the principal men at Majabagadus requested the enemy to come there and take possession, you will be peculiarly careful not to let any of them escape, but to secure them for their evil doings. We now commend you to the Supreme Being, sincerely praying him to preserve you and the forces under your command in health and safety, and return you crowned with victory and laurels. From a postscript to Dr. John Calf's journal, 1780, concerning Majabagwadus. To this new country the loyalists resort with their families, and find asylum from the tyranny of Congress and their tax-gatherers, and there they continue in full hope and pleasant expectation that they may soon re-enjoy the liberties and privileges which would be best secured to them by the British Constitution. Letter from Captain Henry Mowat, Royal Navy, to Jonathan Buck, written aboard HMS Albany, Penobscot River, 15th of June, 1779. Sir, understanding that you are at the head of a regiment of the King's deluded subjects on this river and parts adjacent, and that you hold a colonel's commission under the influence of a body of men termed the General Congress of the United States of America, it therefore becomes my duty to require you to appear without loss of time before General McLean and the commanding officer of the King's ships, now on board the Blonde, off Majabagwadus, with a muster roll of the people under your direction. Chapter 1. There was not much wind, so the ships headed sluggishly upriver. There were 10 of them, 5 warships escorting 5 transports, and the flooding tide did more to carry them northwards than the fitful breeze. The rain had stopped, but the clouds were low, grey, and direful. Water dripped monotonously from sails and rigging. There was little to see from the ships, though all their gunwales were crowded with men staring at the river banks that widened into a great inland lake. The hills about the lake were low and covered with trees, while the shoreline was intricate with creeks, headlands, wooded islands, and small stony beaches. Here and there among the trees were cleared spaces where logs were piled, or perhaps a wooden cabin stood beside a small cornfield. Smoke rose from those clearings, and some men aboard the ships wondered if the distant fires were signals to warn the country of the fleet's arrival. The only people they saw were a man and a boy fishing from a small open boat. The boy, who was named William Hutchings, waved excitedly at the ships, but his uncle spat.
"There come the devils," he said.
The devils were mostly silent. On board the largest warship, a 32-gun frigate named Blonde, a devil in a blue coat and an oilskin-covered cocked hat lowered his telescope. He frowned thoughtfully at the dark, silent woods past which his ship slid.
"To my mind," he said, "it looks like Scotland." "Aye, it does," his companion, a red-coated devil, answered cautiously. "A resemblance, certainly. More wooded than Scotland, though." "Aye, a deal more wooded," the second man said. "But like the west coast of Scotland, wouldn't you say?" "Not unlike," the second devil agreed.
He was 62 years old, quite short, and had a shrewd, weathered face. It was a kindly face with small, bright blue eyes. He had been a soldier for over 40 years, and in that time had endured a score of hard-fought battles that had left him with a near useless right arm, a slight limp, and a tolerant view of sinful mankind. His name was Francis McLean, and he was a brigadier general, a Scotsman, commanding officer of His Majesty's 82nd Regiment of Foot, Governor of Halifax, and now, at least according to the dictates of the King of England, the ruler of everything he surveyed from the Blonde's quarterdeck. He had been aboard the frigate for 13 days, the time it had taken to sail from Halifax in Nova Scotia, and he felt a twinge of worry that the length of the voyage might prove unlucky.
He wondered if it might have been better to have made it 14 days and surreptitiously touched the wood on the rail. A burnt wreck lay on the eastern shore. It had once been a substantial ship, capable of crossing an ocean, but now it was a ribcage of charred wood, half inundated by the flooding tide that carried the Blonde upriver.
"So how far are we now from the open sea?"
he asked the blue-uniformed captain of the Blonde.
26 nautical miles,
Captain Andrew Barclay answered briskly.
"And there,"
he pointed over the starboard bow and past the lion-crested cathead from which one of the frigate's anchors was suspended,
"there is your new home."
McLean borrowed the captain's glass and, using his awkward right arm as a rest for the tubes, trained the telescope forward. For a moment, the small motions of the ship defeated him, so that all he glimpsed was a blur of grey clouds, dark and sullen water. But he steadied himself to see that the Penobscot River widened to make the great lake that Captain Barclay called Penobscot Bay. The bay, McLean thought, was really a great sea lock, which he knew from his study of Barclay's charts was some 8 miles from east to west and 3 miles from north to south. A harbour opened from the bay's eastern shore. The mouth of the harbour was edged by rocks, while on its northern side was a hill crowned thick with trees. A settlement stood on the southern slope of that hill. Over a score of wooden homes and barns were set among patches of corn, plots of vegetables, and piles of timber. A handful of fishing boats was anchored in the harbour, along with one small brig that McLean assumed was a trading vessel.
"So that's Maja Bigwa Juice," he said softly.
"Back topsails," the captain called. "Order the fleet to heave to. I shall trouble you to signal for a pilot, Mr. Fennel."
"Aye, aye, sir."
The frigate suddenly seethed with men running to release sheets.
"That's Maja Bigwa Juice," Barclay said in a tone that suggested the name was as risible as the place.
"Number one gun,"
Lieutenant Fennel shouted, provoking another rush of men who ran to the forward starboard cabin.
"Do you have any idea," McLean asked the captain, "what Maja Bigwa Juice signifies?"
"Signifies?
Aye, does the name mean anything?"
No idea,
Barclay said, apparently irritated by the question. "Now, Mr. Fennel." The gun charged and wadded, but without any shot was fired. The recoil was slight, but the sound of the gun seemed hugely loud, and the cloud of smoke enveloped half the Blonde's deck. The gunshot faded, then was echoed back from the shore before fading a second time.
"We shall discover something now, won't we?" Barclay said.
"Oh, what is that?"
McLean inquired.
"Whether they're loyal, General, whether they're loyal. If they've been infected by rebellion, then they'll hardly supply a pilot, will they?"
"I suppose not,"
McLean said, though he suspected a disloyal pilot could well serve his rebellious cause by guiding HMS Blonde onto a rock. There were plenty of those breaking the bay's surface. On one, not 50 paces from the frigate's port gunwales, a cormorant spread its dark wings to dry. They waited. The gun had been fired, the customary signal requesting a pilot, but the smoke prevented anyone aboard from seeing whether the settlement of Maja Bigwa Juice would respond. The 5 transport ships, 4 sloops and frigate drifted upriver on the tide. The loudest noise was the groan, wheeze and splashing from the pump aboard one of the sloops, HMS North. The water spurted and gushed rhythmically from the elm spigot set into her hull as sailors pumped her bilge.
"She should have been broken up for firewood," Captain Barclay said sourly.
"There's no patching her?"
McLean asked.
"Her timbers are rotten. She's a sieve,"
Barclay said dismissively. Small waves slapped the Blonde's hull, and the blue ensign at her stern stirred slow in the fitful wind. Still, no boat appeared, and so Barclay ordered the signal gun fired a second time. The sound echoed and faded again. And, just when Barclay was considering taking the flotilla into the harbour without the benefit of a pilot, a seaman hailed from the foremast top,
"Boat coming, sir!"
When the powder smoke cleared, the men on Blonde saw a small open boat was indeed tacking out from the harbour. The southwest breeze was so light that the tan-coloured sails hardly gave the boat any headway against the tide, and so a young man was pulling on 2 long oars.
Once in the wide bay, he shipped the oars and sheeted his sails hard so that the small boat beat slowly up to the flotilla. A girl sat at the tiller, and she steered the little craft against Blonde's starboard flank, where the young man leaped nimbly onto the boarding steps that climbed the tumble home. He was tall, fair-haired, with hands calloused and blackened from handling tarred rigging and fishing nets. He wore homespun breeches and a canvas jacket, had clumsy boots and a knitted hat. He climbed to the deck, then called down to the girl.
"You take good care of her, Beth."
"Stop gorping, you puddin'-headed bastards!"
The bosun roared at the seamen staring at the fair-haired girl, who was using an oar to push her small craft away from the frigate's hull.
"You're the pilot?"
the bosun asked the young man. "James Fletcher," the young man said, "and I guess I am. But you don't need no pilot anyways." He grinned as he walked towards the officers at the Blonde stern. "Any of you gentlemen have tobacco?" he asked as he climbed the companionway to the poop deck. He was rewarded with silence until General McLean reached into his pocket and extracted a short clay pipe, its bowl already stuffed with tobacco.
"Will that do?"
the general asked. "That'll do just perfect," Fletcher said appreciatively, then prized the plug from the bowl and crammed it into his mouth. He handed the empty pipe back to the general. "I haven't had tobacco in 2 months," he said in explanation, then nodded familiarly to Barclay. "Ain't no real dangers in Bagadoos, Captain, just so long as you stand off Dice's head, see?" He pointed to the tree-crowned bluff on the northern side of the harbour entrance. "Rocks there, and more rocks off Cross Island on the other side. Hold her in the channel centre, and you'll be as safe as safe."
"Bagadoos?"
General McLean asked. "That's what we call it, Your Honor, Bagadoos. Easier on the tongue than Major Bigwadoose." The pilot grinned, then spat tobacco juice that splattered across the Blonde's holy stone planking. There was silence on the quarterdeck as the officers regarded the dark stain.
"Major Bigwadoose," McLean broke the silence. "Does it mean anything?"
"Big bay with big tides," Fletcher said. "Or so my father always said. Course it's an Indian name, so it could mean anything." The young man looked around the frigate's deck with an evident appreciation. "Day of excitement, this," he remarked genially.
"Excitement?"
General McLean asked. "Phoebe Perkins is expecting. We all thought the baby would have dropped from her by now, but it ain't. And it'll be a girl."
"You know that?"
General McLean asked, amused. "A Phoebe's had 6 babes already, and every last one of them a girl. You should fire another gun, Captain. Startle this new one out of her."
"Mr. Fennel,"
Captain Barclay called through a speaking trumpet.
"Sheet in, if you please."
The Blonde gathered way.
"Take her in,"
Barclay told the helmsman. And so the Blonde, the North, the Albany, the Nautilus, the Hope, and the 5 transports they escorted came to Major Bigwadoose. They arrived safe in the harbour and anchored there. It was June the 17th, 1779, and, for the first time since they had been driven from Boston in March 1776, the British were back in Massachusetts. Some 200 miles west and a little south of where the Devils arrived, Brigadier General Peleg Wadsworth paraded his battalion on the town common. Only 17 were present, not one of whom could be described as correct. The youngest, Alexander, was 5. While the oldest were the 12-year-old Fowler twins, Rebecca and Dorcas, and they all gazed earnestly at the brigadier, who was 31.
"Now what I want you to do," the general said, "is march forward in single file. On the word of command, you stop. Now what is the word of command, Jared?"
Jared, who was 9, thought for a second.
"Halt."
"Very good, Jared. The next command after that will be, prepare to form line, and you will do nothing."
The brigadier peered sternly at his diminutive troops, who were in a column of march facing northwards.
"Understand? You do nothing. Then I'm going to shout that companies 1, 2, 3, and 4 will face left. Those companies..."
And here the general walked down the line indicating which children comprised the leading 4 companies, "are the left wing. What are you, Jared?"
"The left wing,"
Jared said, flapping his arms.
"Excellent.
And you, the general paced on down the rest of the line, are companies 5, 6, 7, and 8, the right wing, and you...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.